Northeast of San Francisco Bay lies Suisun Bay. It is here where the Ready Reserve Fleet, better known as the Mothball Fleet, lays at anchor. Created at the end of World War II and managed by the Maritime Administration, it's the anchorage for approximately 60 vessels from the U.S. Navy and the Merchant Marine. Some are held in a preserved status in case they need to be returned to active duty. A few are held for national defense purposes. Those that have outlived their useful service life and are too costly to upgrade and return to active duty are scheduled to be scrapped. Dismantling these vessels takes place on the Gulf or Eastern Seaboard of the United States. Most are taken to Texas for dismantling. Since these vessels have been demobilized, they must be towed to their destination. To prevent contamination from peeling paint and other contaminants, the ships must be cleaned and prepped for their voyage. To this end, they are put into a local dry dock to be cleaned and decontaminated. This is about the USS Kansas City, an oiler. In the U.S. Navy, an oiler is a combat logistics ship that replenishes other ships at sea with fuel, food, munitions, and mail in a process called underway replenishment, or UNREP. The Navy calls these ships fleet replenishment oilers with a hull designation as AO and the medium-sized oilers as an AOR. The medium-sized oilers, such as the USS Kansas City, were designed as rapid replenishment oilers which could transfer supplies and fuel both in a horizontal connected method or with supplies via vertical methods by helicopter. The USS Kansas City was brought to Suisun Bay in 1994 after 24 years of active duty.
We would adapt with the weather, but most of the time it was pretty good.
Fog watch. I always used to volunteer for fog watch. I loved it out there.
I mean, now that I look back on it, it was a pretty good experience.
The only way I was going to get to ride my motorcycle for a couple months was go sit on that creek.
The primary duty of the ship was to supply other ships with ammunition, diesel fuel, JP-5, which is for aircraft, clothing, food, frozen and frozen and fresh, and mail, and anything else that you can think of. We were literally a floating store. Transfers on the replenishment ship, and that's what we were, was a replenishment ship, would be, there was two different ways that we could do it. And there's a conventional unwrap, which we call conwrap, and then there was a vertwrap, which was used a helicopter. And they would, helicopters and conwrap would, we have ships come alongside of us. We'd all be traveling at the same speed, and they would send a line over, a small line. They would shoot a line over to the other ship, and it's usually a real small stuff line, and then they would have this big rope, or we don't use the word rope, it's line, and it's, then that line is attached to cable, and they bring that across, and then they bring these gigantic hoses, and then they start using booms also to transfer food from one ship to the other.
The things that you see sticking out like that, they're called outriggers. And that's where your hoses, your fuel hoses hung down. I'm not sure the length. Sometimes that little river that got made between the ship that was alongside was always interesting, you know, because they do this every now and then. Wow.
If you notice on the KC, Kansas City, she has a flight deck, and we would palletize everything, bring it to the flight deck in the cargo net underneath it, and the helicopter would pick it up, and they would transfer it over to their flight deck. And usually, like aircraft carriers, the evolution would last 12 hours. Smaller ships would probably be about 4 or 5 hours.
Then when you're out there with the other ships, you know, it's pretty cool looking out in the distance. You can see a aircraft carrier or a destroyer. You know, that's all part of your battle group. And just the duty of an oiler supplying another ship with fuel and food and weapons. You know, you pulling up alongside another ship, you're in the middle of two ships and you got stuff going on each side.
And then everybody gets involved in those, and they hand pack the stuff down. They use working parties to hand pack it down to the different refrigeration storerooms. And everybody gets involved from different departments, divisions. It's an all hands evolution. Depending on where we're at, they have the military or the Navy, or the United States for that matter, has different depots or supply centers throughout the world. And we would go to designated ports. We would be in a convoy. Convoys are a number of ships, and it's usually an aircraft carrier, four or five smaller ships like cruisers, guided missile cruisers, and they've changed a lot now, so I can't remember what the name of them, but the other ships, I'm going to just call them destroyers. And they would go along with us, and plus they always had a submarine with them. But anyway, we would go with that task force, and when we had to replenish the ships, we would go into the closest port that was designated to replenish, and we'd load up and come back out. The ships would send us transmission, meaning communicate with us, telling us what they were going to need for the next vertwrap or unwrap or replenishment that we were going to do them, and then we'd go and supply them with that if they had it in stock.
My job was counseling people, and really was trying to get them to stay in the Navy and make a career out of it, or at least stay another tour. And I was pretty successful in Kansas City because of our ports we visited and everything, and the way the ship was as a whole, and everybody got along pretty good on there. We had a good cheese quarters.
Of course, going overseas, going to the Philippines was great. Going to see the Great Wall in China was great. Going to Korea, going to Australia, you know, going all these different places that you would never probably get to, you know, if you hadn't joined the Navy. So those are some of the stories I would take back and share with my family and my kids and all that.
Singapore was we pulled in there on the Kansas City. It was a nice clean city. Of course, we were in and out of the Philippines, Subic Bay all the time. And I did one experience. I bought a motorcycle before we were getting ready to come home. And it was in the crate, and they loaded it aboard the ship, and they put it in down in the storage area in a hole, we call it. And we had also taken a lift of opportunity sailboat aboard, and then we got orders that we had to extend our cruise, and we went into the Indian Ocean. So the only way I was going to get to ride my motorcycle for a couple months was go sit on that crate.
When I went aboard her, I was really amazed how beautiful she was. And when I say that, she was a beautiful ship. She was spit and polished, and I mean spit and polished.
When I went aboard and I saw the ship the first time I went aboard, I was a Navy recruiter here in Vallejo. And the squadron career counselor took me aboard the Kansas City just for a tour, and he knew I had orders to report aboard. And I noticed it was a clean ship then. It was really nice compared to other surface ship I've been on, or target I call, because I was a submarine sailor.
It was constantly being painted. It looked great. Nothing like what it looks right now. And as I was driving up, I was really saddened by what she looks like, because she was a beautiful ship. She was actually a very, very clean, beautiful ship. And when I say clean, I mean Mr. Clean. The crew worked hard to keep her clean. And it was every day they would do their job of mopping or swabbing, as they would say, and painting and keeping her up. But now I see her and stuff, and it's always sad to see something that you love die, or in this case here, being sent to a place where they're gonna literally cut her up and sell her for razor blades. And that's what we always say when a ship is sold, they sell her for razor blades. But that is sad, and it really breaks my heart. I mean, they did experience a collision during an unrep or replenishment. They're not that often, but they do happen and stuff. And the Navy always practices for that event. They call them emergency breakaways, and they'll just start at somebody on the bridge, is usually the captain, will say emergency breakaway, and they cut all lines and they pull apart as quickly and safely as they can. But sometimes, it just depending on the seas, and the seas are rough. It's very seldom that you'll have a smooth sea, and they can collide.
Kansas City was a good feeding ship. We had good chow in there all the time. I can't remember really a bad meal. There probably were some, but I don't remember it.
One thing we carried a lot of was saltine crackers, because a lot of guys would get seasick, and they would always come to us for saltine crackers to absorb the water or whatever the fluids in them and stuff. But usually on rough seas, we would change our menus because it would be too rough. And a lot of times it would be like sandwiches and stuff like that. But most of the time we try to serve the regular meal that was on board, unless, you know, like if we were supposed to have fried chicken, we would change it to oven-baked chicken or something. But we would adapt with the weather, but most of the time it was fairly good.
Steel beach picnics up on the flight deck, you know, being able to get a barbecue and get a beer after you've been out of sea for, I forget what the regulation was, but you had to be out of sea for so long in order to get a beer. So it was great. It was great.
Here comes a comet, something out early in the morning, just beautiful, gorgeous. And I should have reported it, but I didn't. So who's going to believe you? Seeing a great white shark jumping out of the water, doing a backflip while I'm looking at my cousin's aircraft carrier a couple miles off the starboard beam. I mean, these things happen, but if you're lucky to catch something like that, it's just, the sea is a good life if you're cut that way, you know, but I got out of it what I wanted.
All right, old girl. Kansas City. And one thing that is a good memory is every time we broke away from refueling the ships, they used to play the song Kansas City. I'm going to Kansas City. Kansas City, here I come. They got some crazy little women there, and I'm gonna get me one.
standing on the corner, 12th Street and 9.
Kansas City. Kansas City. I forget who it's by, but they used to play that song. And over the loudspeakers, and that's how we ended our unwraps. Well, my duties as a seaman apprentice was basically maintaining the boat. We chipped paint, sanded it, repainted it, and during unwrap details, we were the ones that was hauling the lines and all that. When I became an interior communications electrician, my duties were make sure all the alarms worked, the phones worked, the gyro compasses, and all those different type of things. We did have a bad experience. We were up off of the Aleutians, and the seas were real rough, and we end up somehow getting a crack in the main deck. We had to pull into the shipyard and get that fixed. So that was unusual.
Life aboard a ship like that is what you make it. I mean, you just, we had a lot of good crewmen, a lot of good people. And if, I will say that from the officers from the top down, for the majority of the people, it was interesting that an auxiliary ship like that would have so many quality folks that I had to work with. Auxiliaries are always considered the unsung heroes of the fleet. And believe me, that's the truth. But it was good duty, I will say that much. It's all give and take in the military, so, you know, they take, you give, and vice versa.
Well, one of the things that that was pretty special is when we crossed the equator, and they call that shellback initiation. So basically, the people who have not crossed the equator before, they're called WOGs or polywogs. And the people who have crossed the equator are called shellbacks. So the day before you cross the equator, all the polywogs are running around the ship trying to, because they know they're going to get it the next day. So they run around the ship and just raise hell. I mean, we did all kinds of stuff. Poured ketchup on people, eggs. I mean, just all kinds of crazy stuff. And then once you go across the equator, it's like a gauntlet you have to go through. And once you come out on the other side, now there's a whole lot of stuff going on in that gauntlet. You're getting hit, you're getting climbing through, crawling through nasty garbage, all that stuff. And then when you come out, you have to say something, and then you become, oh yeah, first the fattest guy on the boat has stuff smeared all on his stomach. And you have to put your face in that mess, and then you become a shellback. So it's basically initiation. Yeah, like I said, it's because I spent 4 years, almost 5 years on the ship, and I have a lot of good memories. You know, there's some bad ones, but there's more good than bad, and. You know, I just hate to see it. One, I hated to see it sitting out in the mothball fleet out there, and now it's sitting here, about to go away. When I went out there on my boat and saw it sitting in the mothball fleet, you know, that was kind of like, wow. That, you know, when I was 18 to 22 ish, you know, that was my home, and so it's sad to see it. Going away. It's really sad to see it going away. Landed at San Francisco airport at night, and then they drive me to Alameda, NAS Alameda, which was where it was stationed at the time. And all you see is this big gray ship at night. I do remember we rescued some refugees. I can't remember exactly where we were at. We were off the coast of China after we rescued the refugees. We dropped our anchor on their boat, make sure it sunk. Just been out of sea, and you know, a lot of people like jog, and we, you know, you can't see it from here, but there's a big long deck, you know, like one deck below the main deck, and people will jog. And as the ship is rocking, as you're walking down you know, you can just watch people as they're jogging, you know, having to sway with the ship, rocking the boat. Sleeping three bunks, you know. When I first got there, I was in the top bunk because I didn't have any seniority. Then eventually moved down to a bottom bunk and then eventually a middle bunk. You know, just the camaraderie that you get from all the, you know, the people your age, you know, everybody's in the same boat, basically. Literally, you're in the same boat. So you have a lot of stuff in common, a lot of things that, you know, you did together. You go out, party together, and a lot of good times, a lot of good times.
We almost ran over a couple whales one time coming up the coast from San Diego to Alameda. And that's about as close as a guy. We were on fog watch. I always used to volunteer for fog watch. I loved it out there, you know. Right there on a pointer, you see the bull nose right there in the middle by the anchor. That's where you stood the fog watch. And there's like a huge table up there if you need to get underneath and protect yourself from bad weather. You got one guy looking with the binoculars, one guy with the sound power phones to talk to the bridge. You know, stuff like that I always found interesting. Good time to take the camera out. Did a lot of growing up over there, you know. It was good. It had its place. It had its place in my life. You know, I think I pretty much got out of it what I wanted. And 4 years was enough. You know, made a lot of good friends, lost a lot of connections. Hopefully everybody's working to try to scramble back. The people that want to be together will get back together, and the people want to remain anonymous, I guess that's the way. But I don't fault it. It was, you know, looking back, it was good duty. It was very good duty. You know, there she is. You know, that says it all right there, as far as I'm concerned. I got a lot of sweat, you know, blood, sweat, and tears on it. I'm not kidding. We used to take such good care of that boat. My God. And it was on the weekends, on a Friday afternoon in Japan, they would buy the deck departments. You know, maybe 60 guys, 55-gallon drum of beer, you know, full of beer. 3 o'clock, knock off ship's work. Oh, you know, because they knew we were doing a good job. And so that's their way of thanking us. Yeah, it's little stuff like that I still remember. To the guys, I did a rough count quick. There's about 4,000 over its career of guys that had worked on there. Boy, those years went fast.
Goodbye, beautiful lady.
They got some crazy